Good morning.
Good morning.
Happy Father's Day to all you fathers out there and those of you that have stepped into that role for others that may not be your children biologically but have filled that role for them. Happy Father's Day to you as well. If you would turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 10, we're going to be looking at verses 23 through 33 this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Verses 23 through 33. We appreciate those of you that were able to be here last night to get to spend that time with you. We really enjoyed ourselves. If you weren't, we understand many of you had other obligations. There are three really important things about myself that I need to share up front. If you can deal with these three things about me, we'll be okay. But if these are issues for you, there's probably something wrong with you. So number one, I enjoy most food left over cold out of the refrigerator the next day. Some may think that's weird. That's your problem. Number two, I think Crocs are the greatest footwear ever made. If my wife would have let me, I would have some on right now. She said maybe not the best time to wear those. But I have many pair of many design, and they are the greatest footwear ever made. Number three, this is the kicker. I'm a Florida Gators fan. Just want to get that out there early. So you know up front, I don't want to be accused of trying to pull the wool over your eyes before we come officially, but just wanted to let you know that. I did share last night, there's more of you here. I'm from Trenton, I grew up here. Anita Callis is my aunt. And so a few years ago, I really began to think, how did I become a Florida Gators fan? And if you know my aunt Anita, you know she's the most obnoxious Tennessee fan ever. So at about 8 years old, I just decided I was going to cheer for who she hated the most. And so I've been a Florida Gators fan ever since. So you can thank her for that, actually, I think. But we're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 23 through 33. If you can, stand with me as we read from God's Word this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 23 through 33, the Apostle Paul writes, "All things are lawful, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful, but not all things edify. Let no one seek his own good, but that of his neighbor. Eat anything that is sold in the meat market without asking questions for conscience' sake. For the earth is the Lord's and all it contains. If one of the unbelievers invites you and you want to go, eat anything that is set before you without asking questions for conscience' sake. But if anyone says to you, 'This is meat sacrificed to idols,' do not eat it for the sake of the one who informed you and for conscience' sake. I mean not your own conscience, but the other man's. For why is my freedom judged by another's conscience? If I partake with thankfulness, why am I slandered concerning that for which I give thanks? Whether then you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do it all to the glory of God. Give no offense either to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God, just as I also please all men in all things, not seeking my own profit, but the profit of the many, so that they may be saved." Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank you for this time we have here in your house this morning, God. We thank you for the wonderful time of worship you already blessed us with, God, the time of fellowship, Lord. God, we thank you today for our fathers, for those that serve in those fatherly roles, God. Lord, we just ask your blessing upon them today, Lord. God, now as we turn our attention to the portion of our worship service where we seek to study your word, Lord, to see what it is you have for us, God, our prayers that you would help each of us to just clear our hearts and our minds of whatever else is going on in our lives, God, that we just focus in on you in these next few moments. And it's in your Son's name we pray. Amen. Be seated. So before we get into the verses, I want to give you just a little background on 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians is a letter written by the Apostle Paul to the church at Corinth. The church at Corinth at this time was a very healthy church in many aspects. However, although they were healthy in many aspects, and they were a very gifted church, they had many ways that they could serve God faithfully and do well. But at this time, they were still a pretty immature church. They were still growing. So this church was very important to the Apostle Paul. And so he writes this letter to address some very specific issues they are dealing with. And beginning in chapter 8 up through chapter 10, they deal specifically with food, with meat that had been sacrificed in the pagan temple. So up until chapter 10, they focused mostly on the meat that had been sacrificed to these pagan gods and eating those in the pagan temples and in their celebrations and in their traditions. Now, in chapter 10, he's going to shift focus a little bit and talk about eating that meat outside of those places. So what would happen is these people that worship pagan gods, they would sacrifice these animals to their pagan gods, and they would have their rituals. Well, then they would take it back to the market and sell it. So the issue they're facing with in here that he's going to deal with is after it's been removed from the pagan temples, it has nothing to do with the pagan gods, it's just meat that they had used, and is it okay to eat that meat? So that's really what he is going to deal with here in these verses 23 through 33. So we'll just go through a verse or two at a time and see what God has to say. So verse 23 again, it says, "All things are lawful, but not all things are profitable. All things are lawful, but not all things edify." So when he says all things are lawful, but they're not all profitable, what he means is just because we have the freedom and the liberty to do something doesn't mean it's always going to be in our best interest. Recently, I've had a renewed interest in fishing. I haven't really fished in many years, and so lately I've really been on a fishing kick, got a new fishing rod, you know, all excited. Lawfully, right now, I could leave this place, I could go to Academy, and I could clean out our bank account on fishing gear. It's legal, but that might not be the most profitable thing for me to do, right? Once my wife was to try to go buy groceries and find out we only had, you know, worms and lures to eat for the next 6 months, that would be an issue for me. So just because we're allowed to do it, and just because it's technically okay, doesn't mean it's always in our best interest. And then the next phrase he says, all things are lawful, but not all things edify. Just because we're allowed to do something doesn't always mean it's in our best interest, but also it doesn't always mean it's the best example and encouragement for others. See, as Christians, we're called, and we're going to look at some verses here in just a couple minutes, we're called to put God first and others second. So even if it's lawful for us to do, and even if it's not necessarily a hindrance to us, we should be concerned of how that would affect others. What example does that set for others? How would that impact other people's walk with Christ? For as Christians, we're called to put ourselves last and to be a sacrifice for others. So then in verse 24, he says, "Let no one seek his own good, but that of his neighbor." If you would turn with me to Matthew chapter 22 quickly, we're going to look at a few verses there. And so before Paul gets into the specifics of dealing with the meat from the pagan markets and being sold and all of that, he's really laying out the principles. First he says, just because it's lawful doesn't mean it's always in your best interest. Then he says, just because it's lawful, it doesn't mean it's the best example. It doesn't mean it's always in the best interest for others for you to do those things. And as Christians, we should be mindful of that. And then he says there in verse 24 that we are to let no one seek his own good but that of his neighbor. So in Matthew chapter 22, in verses 36 through 40, Jesus has been doing some teaching, and he's actually been cornered by some of the religious officials who didn't believe he was who he said he was. And so the Sadducees had questioned him about some things, and then in these particular verses, we see that the Pharisees had really come at Jesus, and they asked him what the greatest law was. Now, they were referring to the Old Testament, the 600 and some odd laws, and they were trying to trip him up. They were trying to get him to say something that they could misuse, that they could pervert into something to make him look bad. But his response is this, in beginning in verse 36 in Matthew 22. He says, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and foremost commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend the whole law and the prophets." What Jesus is saying is, if you truly put God first in your life and put others second before yourself, you'll automatically fall in line with all the laws God has given us. And so what he's saying here, Paul, in this letter, before he even deals with the specific issue, he lays out the principles that Jesus himself had already stated in his ministry. Put God first and others second. If we do those things, the other details, the rest of the issues there will work themselves out. So then in verse 25, he goes on to kind of deal with the issue itself. Paul says, "Eat anything that is sold in the meat market without asking question for conscience sake. For the earth is the Lord's and all it contains." So what Paul is saying is, as Christians, they shouldn't worry themselves of where the meat came from. As Christians, we know that God has given us this earth. God has given us the resources of this earth to take care of ourselves, to provide for our families. And regardless of what others had done with it or any of that, knowing that it came from God, they were okay to eat that. So in this particular issue of what's going on with the meat, he was telling Christians, don't concern yourself with that. If it's there, you can get it, eat it, be full, be happy, move on. He says that we can do that because we know that the earth is the Lord's and all it contains. But then in verse 27, he elaborates on more specifically the issues that they were dealing with. It's not just the meat itself, but the interaction with other people in relation to the meat that had been sacrificed. In verse 27, he says, "If one of the unbelievers invites you and you want to go, eat anything that is set before you without asking questions for conscience sake." Again, he's saying no issue there. If they provide it to you, it doesn't matter where it came from, because ultimately, truly, it came from God. But in verse 28, he says, "But if anyone says to you, this is meat sacrificed to idols, do not eat it for the sake of the one who informed you and for conscience sake." So what was happening is, this was kind of coming about in different scenarios. So Corinth was a nice city at the time. There were lots of interactions between lots of different peoples. And so people that were not Christians, that did not know Jesus as Lord and Savior, would interact on a regular basis with people that were Christians, just like our world today. Whether it be at work or school or whatever you're doing, we interact with people that are saved and are not saved all the time. And so Paul is really addressing three things that could happen here. And so the reason he's saying we should take heed to what others are saying, if someone is saying, hey, this is being sacrificed to idols, he said there's a couple of things. First, they could be doing what they think is best for us. Some people that are not Christians, some people that may be new Christians and less mature in their faith, may think that there are these restrictions and other things placed on Christians. So the idea of certain meats being appropriate and not appropriate to eat came from the Old Testament and some of the restrictions they had and some laws and traditions that were still carried on in this time. And so he's saying for their sake, don't let the issue of whether you should eat it or not get in the way of the opportunity to disciple them. Basically, let the little things go to focus on the big things. So for their sake, don't worry about that. If they think Christians shouldn't eat that, we'll deal with that later. Let's make sure they know who Jesus is. Let's make sure they know Jesus loves them. And we can deal with the smaller issues later on. Also, he says there were issues that could come about when some people were testing Christians. Again, not very different from our culture. New Testament culture at that time, unbelievers were always trying to test Christians, to trip them up, to make them look bad. Unfortunately, we live in a world where that happens in our day and time too. And so again, for the sake of not worrying about the little things and focusing on the big things, Paul says, just don't do it. Because see, just because something is lawful, it doesn't mean it's profitable. Just because something is lawful, it doesn't mean it edifies. And as Christians, our focus should be on growing the kingdom of God and seeing people saved and grow closer to Him. When Paul says in other parts of the New Testament that he lives his life as a sacrifice poured out to God, what he means is he cares nothing about himself, what he gets, what he has, where he lives, none of those things, and pours everything he has into seeing others saved. So then in 29 and into 30, Paul writes, I mean not your own conscience' sake, but the other man's. For why is my freedom judged by another's conscience? If I partake with thankfulness, why am I slandered concerning that for which I give thanks? Again, he's reminding them that a person in right standing with God that has truly accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior, we have freedom through Christ. Through His blood, we were set free from the chains of sin. We were set free from the restrictions and regulations of the Old Testament laws because we have been made clean through Jesus. But just as we've been made clean through Jesus, our focus has been transformed. Our heart's desires has been transformed, and it should be upon the betterment of others, the growing of others in Christ. So then, and this is my favorite verse in the entire Bible, in verse 31, it's very simple, it's very to the point. He writes, whether then you eat or drink, or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. What Paul is saying there, even in the most simple tasks of life, as simple as eating and drinking, you can do everything in a way that honors God. You can do everything in a way that brings glory to God. You can do everything in a way that points others to God. That's amazing. That's awesome. But with that opportunity comes responsibility. Because according to Jesus, this is not just my words, you're either with Him or you're against Him. You know, I'm a big sports fan, and in sports, there's really three groups of people, okay? At a sporting event, let's say a football game, there's three groups of people. There's the home team, there's the away team, and there's people in the stands, right? For the most part, some of those people in the stands aren't really that invested. Sometimes it's just something to do. Sometimes they're just there, you know, to have a good time. But those people on the field are invested. Those kids or athletes or whoever it is, they're invested. They've put effort. They've put time. They've put dedication into this. Well, in terms of serving Jesus, there's no stands. There's no sidelines. You're either on His team or you're on the other team. And so often we get caught up in the idea that there's this area for spectators. One of the things that I struggled with as a teenager, and one of the reasons that I feel very passionately about youth ministry, is the fact that when I had some of the greatest opportunities to influence others for Christ, I chose what I thought was to be a spectator. I was just going to do my thing, and I was going to, you know, do what I wanted to do and go to college and get my degree. And then later on in life, I would serve Jesus. But in reality, that's not how it works. In reality, I ultimately was a hindrance to others. Even as a Christian, I was a hindrance to others. I tell every student that I've ever worked with, They have an opportunity now that most likely they will never have the rest of their lives. Each and every day, our students walk up and down the halls with hundreds of other students. I don't know about you guys, but I've never had a job where I walk up and down the hall with hundreds of other people on a daily basis, that I have an opportunity to actually talk to them, to spend time with them, to share Jesus with them. And so now as I look back, I regret that I wasted those years. And so that's one of the reasons I'm so passionate about youth ministry. So often, youth ministry focuses on getting kids ready for the future, being our leaders in the church in the future, and that's important. But God can use them now. God wants to use them now. And so we have to understand as students, as adults, as Christians, period, that everything we do can be done in a way that honors God. And Jesus told us how in Matthew 22, by putting God first and others second. So then he finishes up this section here of the letter, and he says in 32, give no offense either to Jews or to Greeks or to the church of God, just as I also please all men in all things, not seeking my own profit, but the profit of many, so that they may be saved. To kind of summarize that, Paul says he doesn't care, honestly, what these people do or have done, or what their past is, or things that are still involved today. He wants to tell them about Jesus and be a part of that opportunity that they have to come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. Whatever that means, Paul also says in other parts of the New Testament that he's become whatever it is to whoever it is for their sake and for the sake of Christ. And that's the call we have as Christians. But the reality is, even the simplest things, whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. We have the opportunity in every single thing we do to bring honor and glory to His name. So it's important that we see Scripture in its original form. One of the things a pastor told me very early on in ministry was the Bible can't mean what it never meant. So we have to see it in its fullness when it was written and the circumstances. But what does that mean for us today in 2019 as Christians? What it means for us is that we have that opportunity to bring glory to God in everything we do. But we also have the responsibility to make sure that's what we're doing. There are no sidelines. There's not even cheerleaders, because they're real close to the game, but they're still not in it. You're either with God or you're against Him. By putting Christ first and others second, you will always bring honor to Jesus Christ. Everything you do, if those are your two guiding directives, God first, others second, it'll all work out to bring honor to Jesus. But if you're here today and you're not a Christian, I can confidently tell you, you will not experience contentment, you will not experience joy, and you will not experience purpose in this life without a relationship with Jesus Christ. Here in His Word, He tells us through the Apostle Paul that through a relationship with Jesus, we have the opportunity in everything we do to bring honor to the Creator of the universe, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. But none of that's possible without a relationship with Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. So as we close, I'll leave you with verse 31. Whether then you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father God, we thank You once again for this day. We thank You for this opportunity to be in Your house, God. I thank You for these wonderful people here at First Baptist, God. I thank You for the love, God, the hospitality, and just the overall welcoming they've given me and my family, God. Lord, our prayer today is simply that Your will be done. God, our prayer is that Your will be done in our lives as individuals, God, that in everything we do, we bring honor to You. God, our prayer is that Your will be done in the hearts of any here today that may not be saved, Lord. God, that they would answer the call you've given them, God, to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, God. Brother Jason will be here. I'll be available, Lord. If anyone here today needs to make that decision, God, I pray that you would give them the courage to step out and do that, Lord. God, we also pray that in the decision coming up here in a few minutes, God, regarding your ministry here, God, Lord, we just pray your will be done. God, we just want to honor you. We want to serve you. We want to love you. We just ask all these things in your Son's name. Amen.